held the oceans in his hand, who has numbered every grain of sand. Kings and nations tremble at his voice. All creation rises to rejoice. Behold our God seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Adore him. Amen. Who has given counsel to the Lord? Who can question any of his words? Who teach the one who knows all things? Who can fathom all his wondrous deeds? Behold, behold our God seated on his throne. Come, let us adore him. Of sinful man, God eternal, humbled to the grave, Jesus Savior, risen now to reign. Behold our God seated on his throne, come let us adore him. Fortress is our God.
Our God is a consuming fire, burning holy flame with glory and freedom. Our God is the only righteous judge, ruling over us with kindness and wisdom. We will keep our eyes on you. We will keep our eyes on you. A mighty fortress is our God. A sacred refuge is your name. Kingdom is unshakable. With you forever we will. is our God. A sacred refuge is your name. Your kingdom is unshakable. With you forever we will reign.
A mighty fortress.
Is your name. Your kingdom is unshakable. With you forever we will reign.
With you.
With you forever we will reign.
Our God is a consuming fire, burning
call to worship this morning is from Hebrews. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray your Holy Spirit now would consume us. Over our minds and our hearts, Lord God, that your Holy Spirit would reign, would govern our thoughts, our motives. Right now as we gather, Lord, you called each one of us here by name to worship you and worship you only. And you need to still our hearts, calm us, Lord. Calm our spirits, Lord, as your Holy Spirit is present. We want to worship your name and your name only. As we sing of the mighty fortress, you prevail against all things, Lord God, the attacks of the evil one, Lord. We resist them now as we rest in your mighty fortress. Let us continue to sing powerfully, praise and worship about you, Lord, and you only. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Luther's great hymn.
A mighty fortress is our God. A bulwark never failing. Our shelter
beneath the flood of mortal ills prevailing.
For still our ancient
darkness grim, we tremble not for Question 44, what is baptism? The answer, baptism is the washing with water in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. It signifies and seals our adoption into Christ, our cleansing from sin, and our commitment to belonging to the Lord and to His church. Every person will have one of the following: to be born once and to die twice, or to be born twice and to die once. This depends on their response to their encounter with Jesus. Every person has a physical death, a physical birth, and a physical death. To those who encounter Jesus and reject Him, their death will also be a spiritual one, which is separation from God for eternity. Hence, two deaths. Conversely, if someone responds to Jesus and believes in Him as Lord and Savior, they also have a spiritual birth, and they will never have a spiritual death, for they will be with Christ forever. John 11:26 says, whoever lives and believes in Me shall never die. Do you believe this? Baptism is the outward declaration of this inward reality. So the question is, how important is baptism? The fact that Jesus was baptized gives us some clue. Why would the sinless Son of God need to be cleansed? According to Matthew 13:15, it was to fulfill righteousness. It was to be obedient to the Old Testament law, so He could be high priest in the order of Melchizedek, according to Hebrews 6:20. Here's another fascinating reality. In all that's written in the Synoptic Gospels about Jesus' life, the account of His baptism seems even more poignant, and here's why. Even at the death of Jesus, there were physical manifestations: the shaking of the earth, the raising of the dead from the grave, the tearing of the veil in the temple, or even at His resurrection in Luke 24, where two angelic beings appeared, whose clothes gleamed like lightning, to Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of Jesus, and Joanna. Or even a transfiguration where Moses and Elijah appeared and the voice of the Father was heard and Jesus' face shone like the sun. The baptism seems of utmost importance because it's the only place in the New Testament that the triune God was physically manifested. In the Father speaking, "This is My Son in whom I'm well pleased." In the Son Jesus who was being baptized. And in the Holy Spirit who descended like a dove. Matthew 3:16-17. This starts 3 intense years of ministry that Jesus would endure, which would conclude with His eventual death and resurrection. His immersion and raising from the water would also be symbolic to those present there of what His future would be, more so than they could have ever imagined. So to those who are in Christ, baptism is their declaration to the world that they are dead to sin and that they are alive in the Spirit, but also that death has been put to death. Death, where is your sting? Grave, where is your victory?
Amen. Amen. Thanks for that, Sanjeev. And let's stand, and we're going to sing Who You Say I Am, which is about our identity in Christ.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Yeah, His love for me. The sun sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Free at last.
Free at last, He has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, He died for me. The sun sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
In my Father's house.
In my Father's house. There's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who You say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who You say I am.
I am chosen again.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who You say I am.
You are for me.
You are for me, not against me. I am who You say I am. I am who You say I am. The sun sets free. Oh, it's free. Child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes, I am.
Again, to the sun,
who the sun sets free. Oh, it's sweet.
Come on, church.
I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. I'm a child. Child of God, yes I am. Yes I am.
One more, yes I am.
Yes I am.
You may be seated.
Good morning, church. Good morning, children. Did anyone see the rainbow Friday night? Amazing, right? Amazing, beautiful, and meaningful. And kids, when we see a rainbow, just like it is in Genesis 9:14, He says, when I bring a rainbow to cover the earth, look for my bow, the rainbow. And the rainbow is the sign that everything's gonna be okay, just like the song, everything's gonna be all right. And so we look at the sun and know that there's another day coming. And kids, our days get cloudy. Maybe a friend at school makes us really mad, or we make our brother and sister mad, and you get a cloudy day. But you got to remember that Jesus brings the sun out. And when there's those clouds and those raindrops, a rainbow is just right around the corner. So we always want to search for that rainbow. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for these mommies and daddies and caretakers out there that don't stop searching for the rainbow, and those constant drops of rain coming out of the sky are your words, are your everlasting words, that we believe in you and we will continue to search for all the rainbows that we can. And as we get this rain this week, let us remember to look up to the sky and know that everything is gonna be all right. Kids, let's go to Miss Liz.
Good morning. Well, it turned out pretty nice. It was a little cold earlier, but it's pretty bearable now, yeah? What a beautiful, beautiful morning. And the rain is always appreciated, so the Lord has blessed us with rain, and I guess more is coming, so that's a good thing. Now, this morning, we have the privilege of being able to open God's Word and to hear from Him. We've been studying the book of Matthew, as you're well aware, and Jesus is now in this last week of ministry on the earth, as before He goes to be with His Father, before the crucifixion, resurrection, and ascension. And He begins to upgrade His teaching and be more specific towards the religious leaders of His day. You remember the last couple of times we've met, we've talked about Jesus cleaning the temple, recognizing the fact that the Pharisees and the Sadducees have turned the temple into a marketplace. And Jesus overturns the tables and tells them, "You've turned my Father's house into a marketplace." This was to be a prayer, a place of prayer for the nations. And then last week we talked about how He cursed the fig tree because the fig tree produced no fruit. It was all leaf and no production. And how He related that to the fact that some of us are all show and no go in our relationship with Jesus Christ, and how we need to be able to bear fruit, and we need to bear fruit for the kingdom of God so that He would be glorified in and through us, that our faith is a living and active faith. And as He finishes condemning the fig tree, He goes back into the temple. And you remember the last time He was in the temple when He overturned the money changers and the shoppers and the shopkeepers. He begins to heal, and He begins to teach, and He begins to have the children are actually worshiping Him and giving Him glory and thanks. And the religious leaders are getting more and more angry and more uptight about this. And so this morning we have, we continue our time with the Pharisees and Jesus has experience with them. And so we're going to pick up our reading in Matthew chapter 21, verses 23 through 32, I believe it is. So let's turn to the Lord and turn to His Word as we continue our time in the Word. Jesus entered the temple courts, and while He was teaching, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to Him. "By what authority are you doing these things?" they asked. "And who gave you this authority?" Jesus replied, I will also ask you one question. If you answer me, I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. John's baptism, where did it come from? Was it from heaven or from men?" And they discussed this among themselves and said, "If we say from heaven, He will ask, then why didn't you believe Him? But if they say from men, we are afraid of the people, for they hold that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." Then He said, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Go, son, go and work today in the vineyard.' 'I will not,' he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. When the father went to the other son and said the same thing, he answered, 'I will, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two sons did what his father wanted?" "The first," they answered. And Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth, that tax collectors and the prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you to show you the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. And even after you saw this, you did not repent and believe him." Lord God, as we turn to your word, we ask that you would enlighten our hearts and our minds, and that you would give us a real sense of your insight into these things so that we might apply them to our lives, and that we might live more holy in your presence, and that you would help us to be greater witnesses to the world around us. We thank you, Lord, for this word, and we offer it up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. So Jesus is back in the temple courts, back teaching. And you remember when Jesus was 9 years old and his parents were looking for him? And they were like 3 days out of Jerusalem, and they were looking for Jesus because they were one of the festivals, and they, where's our son? And so they go back to the temple and they find Jesus in the temple, teaching in the temple. And the parents asked Jesus, why did you do this? And Jesus' response, wouldn't you know that I would be about my Father's business? And so Jesus has a claim on the temple. This is his Father's house. To him, it's like home. To him, it's the place where people ought to be able to meet the Lord, meet the Heavenly Father, and worship him. But the Pharisees and the scribes and the religious leaders come to him, and they ask him a couple of questions. And the couple of questions weren't just innocent little questions. They were questions to try and trap him. Now, the Pharisees were always trying to trap him. The Pharisees were always trying to make him commit a sin of blasphemy, more mainly. And as they came to him, they asked him, by what authority do you do these things? Now, when you hear the word authority, we have a personal and many times a very emotional response to that word. Think about what's going on in our nation today. Think about what's going on in our world today. Where is their authority? And whose authority are you going to trust? And whose authority will you follow? I can remember back in the late 60s and early 70s, maybe some of you will remember this too, a slogan that said, question authority. How many of you remember that slogan from way back when? Yeah. And the idea of the questioning authority was a way to question the validity and the power of those who were overseeing you, such as the government or the police. Could they truly be trusted? Could we trust their authority so that we would follow them? In today's economy, in today's world today, that question is being asked even more. Can we trust our government? Can we trust the police that are there to protect us? You see, this idea of authority is such a powerful, powerful thing. It carries a deep sense of privilege and power. It denotes a rule and influence and control over others. When someone has authority, it means that they have the power to determine things and to render judgments and consequences of those in their care. For instance, a boss has authority over his or her employees. That boss is able to tell their employees what to do, and if they want to continue to work for that boss, that they would obey and do what that boss wants them to do. But here in our passage, we need to take a closer look at the direction of Jesus. By what authority does Jesus do these things? To me, it's amazing that they felt this question needed to be asked. But again, they wanted to trap him into blasphemy. You see, Jesus' authority has been a witness throughout the Gospels. Matthew 7:28, at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, the people were astonished because he taught them as one who had authority. He would say things like, you've heard it said that you should not commit adultery, but I tell you that if you look with a woman with lust, you have committed adultery in your heart with her already. You see, Jesus was unique in his teaching. He didn't have a set of commentaries in his library at home that he had to refer to. He didn't have a list of favorite authors that he would go to in order to make his case. He would make his case based on his own thinking, his own way of doing it. Jesus said this, a new command I give to you, that you love one another. You see, Jesus' authority was not only the authority to be able to teach what he wanted, but to make new commands. There were the Ten Commandments, but Jesus gives another one in John 13. In Mark chapter 1, verse 22, Jesus is in Capernaum, and he's teaching in the synagogue. And the people were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one who had authority. You see, Jesus had authority on anything he wanted to teach on. In Mark chapter 2, we see a paralytic that's being lowered through the roof of a house. And as that person is being introduced to Jesus, Jesus says something very, very unique. He says to that paralytic, "Your sins are forgiven." And the scribes and the Pharisees says, "What kind of person can forgive sins? Only God can forgive sins." And what does Jesus say in response? He says, "I do this so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority to forgive sins." So he says to the paralytic, "Pick up your mat and go home." And Jesus comes to the storm in Matthew chapter 8. And you remember the disciples on the Lake Galilee. And as they're on the lake, the big storm comes up and they're afraid for their lives. These big, strong fishermen are crying to Jesus, "Don't you care? Wake up. Save us." And Jesus' response is he calms the wind and the waves. And their response, the disciples' response is, "Who is this that has authority even over the winds and the waves that they would obey him?" You see, Jesus has authority over what he says. He has authority over nature. He has authority over physical disease. He has authority over death itself. You remember in John chapter 11, where Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. And so we ask the question, where does this authority come from? Matthew 28, a very familiar passage to us, Jesus says this in the Great Commission. He says, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth." I could go on, but I think we get the point that Jesus has authority over all of life. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. When we come to him as followers of Christ, as Christians, we recognize that he has ultimate authority over our lives. We don't just add Jesus on to our lives, but we come in confession, in repentance, at the mercy and grace of Christ himself. But where did he get this authority from? Why does Jesus have this power? Why does Jesus have this authority? In John chapter 10, verse 17 and 18, Jesus says this, "The reason my Father loves me is that I lay my life down, only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father." So where does Jesus get his authority from? The Father. "I do what the Father shows me, and that is exactly what I do." That's what he says in John 5. And this idea of the authority, what does that mean? What does that word entail? Well, it comes from two Greek words. One is dunamis, and the other one is exousia. The first one, dunamis, means power or the ability to do something. So one who has authority has the power to be able to do whatever that person desires to do or whatever that person wants to do. The idea of exousia is a Greek word that means that person has the right to be able to exercise that power over whomever they have authority over. It is a right and a privilege that that person has. So when Jesus comes to the earth and he says that the Father has given him that authority, Jesus has been given the right to have the authority over all of creation. In John chapter 1, there was nothing that was made that wasn't made except through Christ Jesus. He has the authority over all of his creation. In John 17, in his priestly prayer, before he's going to be with the Father, he says, "Father, now the time has come to glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. You granted him authority over all the people, that they might give eternal life, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given to him." Now the chief priests and the elders should have known this, just like we should know this. The question I have for us at this stage is, Do you know that Christ has authority over your life? Have you yielded your life to the Lord? Have you repented of the fact that you have offended a righteous and holy God and have fallen at his mercy? The chief priests and the elders didn't get it. You see, what's going on is that they asked Jesus why he has this authority, because they thought they had the authority. They were the leaders of the temple. They were the sophisticated religious ones. They were the ones that knew all the answers. And yet, Jesus comes to them and helps them realize that they've missed the mark. You see, the Pharisees and the scribes and the Sadducees come to Jesus and ask him, "Where are your ordination papers?" You see, Jesus didn't go to Caiaphas and ask for permission to teach in the temple. And Jesus assumed his own authority and went to the temple to teach. And Jesus responds to their question with the question himself. He's asked the question, see, this question that Jesus asked was a common thing that happened in rabbinical debate. He wasn't evading or avoiding the question, but he was confronting them with a debate. And he asked the question in a form of, who is it that has authority? I'll ask you a question. Did John's baptism come from heaven or from men? And now the Pharisees and the Sadducees are in a pickle because they have to make a choice. That reminded me of when I was a kid. I don't know if you know what this word comes from, being in a pickle. Does everybody know what that means? I know Dwayne does because he's a baseball player. But being in a pickle is you have one base over here and one base over here, and you have two guys, and you're throwing a ball back in the force, and you have a runner in between. And the runner tries to get to one base or the other base safe without being tagged. That's how I remember the pickle. It wasn't like you were in a pickle, like in a jar of, you know, a pickle or anything. But they were in a dilemma. That's the point I'm trying to make. They were in a dilemma, and the dilemma was this, that if they said that they believed that the baptism of John or the ministry was from John, that was from heaven, and they would have to admit to the fact that Jesus was the Messiah, because they would have recognized that John was a prophet. And what John told us was that Jesus was the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. They would have to admit that Jesus was the Messiah. But if it was of men, they were afraid that the people would rise up and their credibility with the people would be shot. And so what did they do? And they did what many of us probably would do. They took the path of least resistance. The path of least resistance is a very common path to take, isn't it? And they didn't want to make a decision between the two because they were afraid of either having to admit one thing or afraid of the people that might not like what they had to say. It's very typical. Now, they were more concerned about their popularity than they were about being obedient to God. They took the chicken way out. And so Jesus replies, "Therefore, I won't tell you what authority I have to do the things that I have to do." But this leads us to the second parable. Before we get down on the Pharisees too much for taking the path of least resistance, how many times have I taken the path of least resistance? How many times have you taken the path of least resistance? How easy is that path going to be for us to take and during these times? The path of least resistance that says, I don't want to offend anybody with what I believe, what I know to be true from the scriptures, what I know to be true about my beliefs and convictions, about what God says in his word. When we live in such a pluralistic society, a pluralistic culture, the word of God stands out more boldly than ever before. The priests and the scribes refused to answer Jesus because they were hypocrites. They didn't believe John. And their faith was fake. And they took the path of least resistance. But I like how Jesus engages them. He engages them by saying this, "What do you think?" That's a good question to ask people sometimes when you're talking to them about spiritual things. What do you think? And that gets them personally involved. It gets them set up for when Jesus is going to condemn them for their fake religion. And the parable is about two sons. The first son, he asks, "Go to my vineyard and work in the vineyard." And the first son says, "No, I'm not going to do that. Sorry, I can't do that. I got too much going on, or I'm busy." But later on, he looks at his life and he says, "I better go do what my father asks," and goes and works in the vineyard. The second son says the same, or the second son, the father asks the same question. And the second son is very polite. Notice the word he says, "I will, sir, I will go." But he doesn't go. See, he's taken the last path of least resistance. He doesn't want to offend his father, but he doesn't want to go and do the work in the vineyard as he's asked. So Jesus asked the question, which one did what the father wanted? And as I was thinking about that question, you're going to think this is kind of weird, but I was thinking about fly fishing. And you say, okay, why were you thinking about fly fishing? Well, in fly fishing, it's all about how the fly hits the water that attracts the fish. And Jesus' parables is all about how the parable hits the person to attract the response. You see, Jesus didn't get the response out of them when he asked them to talk about the authority that they had, but Jesus gets the response here. He gets the response so that he can pursue his condemnation of their religious fakeness, if that's a word. And as he says that, which one did what the father wanted, they bite the first one. And Jesus goes, "Yes! Got him." And this is why he says why I think he's got him, because he's put them now in a position where he can confront their thoughts. And Jesus was being confronted, and Jesus was helping them realize that they needed to turn from their religion and turn to Christ as their Lord and Savior. And he says this, "Tax collectors and prostitutes are going to get to heaven before you do." Now, this would have been a very hard thing for these people to hear. They were the religious elite. They were the ones that went through all the ceremonial stuff. And they went to church every Sunday. They went to synagogue every day. They prayed 3 times a day. They did all the things that were required of the law in their own eyes. And these prostitutes and tax collectors represented the scum of the earth. The tax collectors were very well looked down upon. In fact, in Luke chapter 5, verse 32, Jesus is being confronted in the house of Levi. And you remember Levi was a tax collector, and the Pharisees come to him and say, "Why are you and your disciples eating with sinners?" Meaning the tax collectors. And Jesus' response is this, "Because I didn't come to save the self-righteous, but I came to save sinners to repentance." He sees people that are self-righteous can never go to heaven. And they think they've got it together. They might have a little religion here, a little Jesus there, a little Christianity here, a little bit of the world over there, and they make up their own religion. The Pharisees and the Sadducees, in essence, were making up their own religion because they refused Christ. In our world today, in a syncretistic world that we live in, we are in a culture that makes up their own religion. It might sound Christian, but in many senses of the word, it doesn't mean Christian. It might have the term evangelical applied to it, but when you look into their teaching, it's not evangelical at all. But it's man-made, man-centered, not God-made and not God-centered. See, the irony of this whole thing is that the ones that should have got it didn't get it, and the ones that should not have got it did get it. This includes you and me, doesn't it? I was lost until Jesus found me. I was on my way to hell and damnation. Not just being away from God, but being in a present place forever of torment and righteous judgment. You see, for the self-righteous, the people that think they have it all together on their own merit, they are still lost in their sins. They are still lost and need a Savior. And maybe some of us today are in that position. We are like the first son. We are like the one who said, yes, I go to church every day, I read my Bible every day, but I've never repented. I've never turned my life over to Christ. I've played the religious game, but I really have never had a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Maybe there's someone that's listening to this that acknowledges the fact about them. I've got good news for you. Repent and believe the good news that Jesus died for you, that Jesus covers your sins by the cross. The blood that was shed on his cross covers your sins for all of eternity. Today may be a day where you want to stop practicing and pretending and posing what real faith is about, but you want to come to a true, real encounter with the risen Christ. And today might be a day where the Holy Spirit grabs a hold of your heart and wins him to himself. You see, the scribes and the Pharisees, they missed their chance. They let their opportunity go. Don't let that opportunity pass you by. When the Lord calls, answer. When the Lord draws you, surrender. And the primary meaning of this passage is really clear, that God requires of us that we live under his authority, that he has the power and he has the right to exercise his will upon this world because he is the creator of all things. He has the power and the right to exercise his will upon our lives because he loves us. You see, all authority was given to Jesus. But what did Jesus do with that authority? He went to the cross for you. He went to the cross for me. He laid down his life only to take it up again because he had that authority. And he gives and offers eternal life to all that would come in repentance and faith. Could that be you today? Maybe you've done the Christian religious thing, but now today would be a day where you surrender your life to Jesus. You acknowledge the fact that you are a sinner in need to repent and come in faith. Don't let this opportunity go by. As the world gets more crazy and more uncertain as we go forward in our age, we recognize that there's one thing that'll never change, and that is the Lord. Heaven and earth will change and pass away, but his word will never pass away. He is the God of all of eternity, and the God of all of eternity came in Jesus Christ to pay the price for you and for me. And it is the one thing, like that rainbow we talked about, that we can hold on to and know for sure that God wins, that it will turn out in the end, but he's got work for us to do in the meantime. And we need to stand strong during these times. Can you stand strong? The body of Christ needs you to. The Lord expects us to. The Lord is calling us to. He's equipping us to. He gives us the grace to be able to do it and the joy to be obedient. It's all about authority. Who has authority over your life? It's all about obedience. Who are you really going to obey? Is the authority in your life Jesus? Will you obey him? Will you come? Will you follow? Will you be led by his Spirit? May today be the day that you experience the joyful sense of obeying the one who truly loves you and truly left his life for you, the one who is preparing a place for you so that you might have eternity with him for all of that eternity. Let's pray together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you that you have all of authority, that you are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and that authority, Lord, has been demonstrated in your word, and that you have authority over all of creation. You have authority over what you say. You have authority of this world. You have authority over sickness and disease. You have authority over death itself because you defeated death. You conquered death. You died on the cross, but you rose again on the third day, and now you are interceding for us in heaven, giving us your Spirit so that we might stand strong during these uncertain times. And we thank you, Lord, for the privilege and the joy to be able to serve you during these times, because you have called us to be strong and courageous during these times so that you might be glorified and that people will know that Jesus is Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
We're going to respond with a new song from Psalm 65. Psalm 65 states, "Praise awaits you, O God in Zion. To you our vows will be fulfilled. O you who hear prayer, to you all men will come." Amen. Please stand. Awaits you, with your people, praise awaits you, here in Zion, praise awaits you, oh God. We are feeble, you are awesome, we are feeble, you are awesome, you are righteous, you are awesome, oh God. Raised up, to your courts, you invite us, choosing hearts. Only Zion, to your courts we come. When we're overwhelmed by sin, our transgressions you forgive. Now in Zion we remain. If you look at Psalm 65 today, you can read through that. It's almost exactly that song. So be blessed by the Psalms.
Good morning, church. It's so good to see you all here this morning. It's time for our praises and joys and our concerns to lift up to our precious God in heaven. Thank you, Eternal Father God, for the birth of CJ at 26 weeks. We praise you for giving him life, for his weight gain, and his well-being. We ask you to continue to safeguard CJ and to enable him to continue to fully develop and grow. We thank you for the purposes that you have already ordained for him. Give his parents strength and courage and trust in you. Please heal the world of COVID, make it safe for all businesses to reopen. We thank you, God, our great physician, for the successful replacement of Gene's knee. We ask you to protect him from infection and complications. Give him strength and endurance and a full recovery. Please let his pain be minimal and manageable. We lift up my cousin Charlotte and pray that you will cause her surgery to be successful. We ask that you would fully heal her. Give her and her husband, Steve, peace. Thank you for the creative gifts you've given Valerie. We ask for your favor on Valerie's screenplay, The Decision, during its review for possible production by Believe Entertainment. We ask that if this movie would help lead people to accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior, that it would be produced and seen. We ask for reconciliation for our country and the world, for your justice and your mercy and your love to reign. Mighty God, we ask for your protection over our pastors, our congregants, and churches around the world. We pray for those who are mourning those who were killed in the massacre in Ethiopia today. 750 people pulled out of their church and killed. Father, help those who are mourning. Help your servants to persevere. And I pray, Father, for your protection around those who survived. Safeguard the deliverance of your true word, Father, freedom of speech and freedom of worship. Give your people the desire and will to act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with you, our Lord of Lords, our King of Kings, and Savior, our Redeemer. Please join me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen.
That's fine. That's good. Thank you. Amen. Thank you, Maida. As we continue to worship the Lord and let us do so in the giving of our tithes and offerings, recognizing the fact that our Lord is so good to us and we want to return what he's already blessed us with. So let us continue to worship in the giving of our tithes and our offerings.
Thanks, Dave. Precious Lord, take my hand. Amen. A couple of notes coming up in February. On February 14th, Nita Hansen is going to be one of our missionaries from the Ukraine, I think, is going to be preaching on February 14th. And then the 28th, 2 weeks later, is going to be our annual meeting and the installation of Pastor Glenn Beatty, in the worship service, so all the songs will be 70s rock and roll. Sorry, no worship that day. Speaking of obeying, let's stand and sing Trust and Obey.
Authority and obedience. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May you go under his authority because he loves you. He knows the best for us. He came and died on the cross. He expressed his authority that you might have eternal life. So go with that message in your heart and on your lips. Be bold. Do not take the road of least resistance, but proclaim him, King of kings and Lord of lords. And may the God of all grace and comfort be your source of grace and comfort today. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you. Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you.